You guys ready for the word of the Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Get your Bibles out. Let's go before the Lord together in prayer tonight. If you have the ability, would you honor the Lord? Stand your feet. I'm going to get down on my knees and let's go before the Lord together in prayer tonight. Father, we're just so grateful, God, that, Lord, first and foremost, we can come into the house of God and put a smile on our face. God, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. Oh, God, we thank you, Father, for the joy of the Lord, which is our strength in this place tonight, that we can laugh, that we can have the joy of the Lord in our hearts, and that it can carry out into every area of our lives. Tonight, Lord, as we hear your word, God, we pray for just your Holy Spirit to come and speak to us. Tonight, we didn't come to hear from a man or a woman, from the young or the old, from the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. Today, Lord, we came to hear from you. Holy Spirit, be welcome in this place. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even the correction we need for our lives. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are both preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. There are brothers and sisters, Lord, and at no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-workers and laborers in your kingdom, building one kingdom, that's yours, God, building in your field, God, reaping the harvest of souls for the kingdom of God. And so, Lord, we thank you for what you're doing on the earth through all the churches, God. And Lord, we pray, Father God, a specific prayer blessing over our nation right now, God. Uncertain times, Lord, lots of confusion, lots of things going on. But God, we know that Jesus is on the throne and that's what counts. So we pray for our leaders. We pray for wisdom. God, we pray for the elections upcoming, God, and we thank you, Lord, that you will have your way in our nation, God. Your kingdom come, your will be done on the earth as it is in heaven. We declare it and we receive it now. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Tonight, I have a message that I believe the Lord gave me just for each and every one of us in this place. It's called, Help, I'm Overwhelmed. And maybe you heard that this morning and you said, oh, praise God, he has heard my cry because I am totally overwhelmed. You know, I think each and every one of us at one point or another in our lives gets to a place where we just have to throw our hands up and just say, I can't do anything else. I'm just completely and totally overwhelmed. When I look at the term actually being overwhelmed in the Bible, it literally means to faint. Like you're just done. You're out of energy, you're out of strength, and you're just gone, right? You pass out basically. And that's really what it's talking about. Or the other imagery that we get from the Bible is that something is completely covered, that it's swallowed up. Almost like when you jump into the pool or maybe you're swimming in the ocean and a wave comes and it overwhelms you. Some of you guys have had that experience before, right? There you are swimming in the ocean and all of a sudden, the wave comes over and it overwhelms you. And throughout our lifetime, there will be different scenarios. Sometimes it'll happen when your children are out of order, you know, and here you are a young parent, maybe a single parent, and the kids are going crazy, they're lighting fires, they're, you know, drawing on the walls, that sort of a thing, and you just have to say, oh my goodness, I'm overwhelmed. Some of us, it happens on the job. You get more and more responsibility and more things coming at you and several things coming at you in every direction. And eventually the boss is on your back asking you for more and more and more. I was just sitting with somebody recently. They have a job in sales and they said when it comes to the end of the quarter, three times a day they have the corporate offices calling them, asking them, how many did you sell now? And then at noon, how many did you sell since this morning when we called you? And then at 4 o'clock, how many did you sell since noon? I mean, that could drive anybody crazy and push you over the edge. Maybe for some of you, it's in the community, and you've watched the neighborhood go down and down and down and down, and you've been watching the news, and you've seen the tensions in our nation between the different races, the different things going on with the police officers. And it's been on the rise, and now all of a sudden it's come to your neighborhood, and you throw up your hands, and you say, help, God, I'm overwhelmed. I had an experience. I was working here at the church, and there was an issue that kept coming up. And it seemed like everywhere I turned, that same issue would come up over and over and over again. And it was kind of, you know, it was okay. We were working on it. And, you know, I prayed about it. But it was basically like, Lord, you know, here this thing is, give me wisdom type of a prayer. You know what I mean? And that's good. And that does definitely help. And we were starting to make some headway on it. But this issue kept coming up and kept coming up and kept coming up. And it seemed like everywhere I turned, every meeting I'd have, every knock on the door, every phone call happened to be this same issue. And as I'm looking at this issue, I'm going, okay, God. And, you know, it's almost like you can feel the waters rising. And until I'm up to my neck in this issue. And I remember there was a point where I opened up an email one day. I came into the office. First thing I do is I get my computer going, get my computer started, you know, and I take a look at my emails to make sure that I'm all caught up and everything before I get going on my day so I can kind of prioritize based on what's coming in. Okay, I need to look at this. I need to have this time. I've got this set aside for study, this set aside for meetings, that sort of a thing. And so I opened up my emails, and the very first email that I got was the same issue. And it was almost like the straw that broke the camel's back. And I remember just taking a deep breath in, and the tears just started to stream down my face. I was completely and totally overwhelmed. And I fell to my knees before the Lord, and I said, God, I can't. I'm just done. I'm overwhelmed. But you know what? Each and every one of us, when we come to those times that we realize something, that we're overwhelmed, I have good news for you, because the Bible talks about this very subject. In fact, you'll find men and women of God throughout the Bible who experienced overwhelming circumstances. They faced obstacles and things that we've never faced in our lifetime. And one of the neat things that I love about it is that there is a collection of thoughts, if you will, a collection of poems, a collection of prayers called the Psalms. And in these thoughts and poems and prayers, you will find the heartbeat of great men and women who went before us and who shared what was going on in their lives. Turn with me to the book of Psalms, chapter number 61. Psalm chapter number 61. And in Psalm 61, we see a heart that's completely and totally overwhelmed. We get to hear about a guy who threw his hands up and said, I can't. I'm just done. Look at what it says in Psalm 61, the introduction to the psalm says, to the chief musician on a stringed instrument, a psalm of David. So we know this is David. This is the great king. This is the one who killed the lion and the bear, the one who took out the giant, the champion of the Philistines, Goliath. This is the one who became king, and yet David had a lot of hardship in his life. David was forgotten oftentimes and was left out. David had the former king Saul trying to kill him, trying to pin him to a wall with a spear. He was chasing him. He had to go and hide in caves. David, when his army came to him, it wasn't the mighty, but it was the misfit. It was the people who were indebted, the people who were outcasts. And these were the guys that David was going to lead to become his mighty men. David had people in his own household after he had messed up royally. He had people in his own household as a consequence of his sin that rose up and tried to take the kingdom from him and messed with his family and messed with his life and messed with his future. And he had a lot of hardship. And here we see David in verse number 1, say this, hear my cry, O God, attend to my prayer. From the end of the earth, I will cry to you. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Now let's stop right there. We're going to go through this entire psalm tonight because I believe this psalm shows us what to do when you're overwhelmed. It shows us how to get the help that we need from God. Because really, this psalm just started out as a cry, help, God, I'm overwhelmed. And that's really what David is saying. And the first thing that we need to do, if we're going to get help, is just realize the problem. You got to realize the problem. I have a friend who owns a boat, and he invited me and my family to go out with him on the boat. And so we went down to Lake Paris there on the south side of Moreno Valley. And, you know, we took it out and we're going around. And this boat could rip, man. I mean, it's got two engines underneath. And I mean, he would just light that thing up, wah, you know, and that thing would kind of come up out of the water and get going real fast. And he'd turn it and you'd feel the water spraying up in your face. And then he'd turn it back and then the wind is in your face. And I mean, it's a lot of fun. And at one point, they inflated this raft that they pull behind the boat, right? And they called it Big Mama. And so the kids are all getting out on Big Mama, and they're getting pulled around, you know, and it kind of skips on the water, and they go back and forth and let the little thing be pulled over the wakes, and it's a lot of fun. And after a while, we got the girls out on the, you know, got the wives out there. And so the wives are out there, and we're having fun, and we're pulling them and that sort of a thing. And, you know, everybody's having a good time. And then they said, well, hey, would the husbands like to go out? You know, why don't you men go out on the Big Mama? And so we said, all right. And so me and my buddy, we get out there on Big Mama. And as we get out there, it was almost like something came over his wife. I don't know what it was, but she just got this mean streak. And she hit it. You know what I mean? Anybody who's been on a boat, hit it, right? And all of a sudden, that thing just lit up, and I'm holding on for dear life, right? And I don't like this kind of a thing. I'm not like, you know, I'm not a big fan of like snowboarding and that kind of thing. You know, give me beach volleyball, give me a frisbee. I'll go swim. I'll do any. I'll ride a bicycle. I will hike. That's my outdoor stuff, right? But being dragged behind a boat at who knows how many miles per hour or knots per minute, who knows what it was, just was not fun. And so here I am like, and I'm holding on, and apparently that wasn't good enough because I wasn't flying off of it yet, so she went even faster. I see my wife's over there just laughing, right? I can't hear a thing because all I hear is... And so she starts doing that S pattern thing, you know. And so here comes Big Mama, wham, 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 over the water. And at one point, she turned all the way around, and then she, like, jerked it, wham, and she hit it, and that thing went, and all of a sudden, I'm watching, and it was almost like a scene in a movie where you're watching the water, you know, you're kind of, like, in slow motion, no. And all of a sudden, I see the rope just go up out of the water, and hit straight, and it snapped. Bang! We got just lifted out of the water. That Big Mama turned straight over. I went this way. My buddy went that way. I think we collided somewhere in the air. Maybe his knee or his head or something hit me in the rib cage. And I went into the water. I had no idea what happened. I didn't have a moment to breathe in air before I went into the drink. It was like just complete overwhelming, right? I was in the water, and I realized I had a problem. I did not know which way was up. Thankfully, I had a vest on that was carrying me up the whole time, and I just stopped moving, and I realized if I can just do nothing right now, I will get lifted up out of the water. See, for all of us, we have to realize what's going on. We have to realize the circumstances. We have to realize that there is something happening that we need to get a hold of. And oftentimes, the best thing to do is to not do anything. Just wait and give it some time. Realize the problem. See, how you handle when you're overwhelmed determines if it's your greatest tragedy or your greatest victory. Let me say that to you again. How you handle when you are overwhelmed, when the circumstances are just too much, and now it has completely swallowed you up, and you have fainted, right? And you're out, and you just throw up your hands, and you say, help, God, I'm overwhelmed. See, when you realize that point, and you stop, how you handle it determines whether or not it's your greatest victory or your greatest tragedy. So what do? Well, here's the first thing we do, is we have to release our prayers. Just like King David did. You have to release your prayers. There is power when we pray. There is lifting power, just like that vest lifted me up out of the water. Your prayers will literally lift your soul. They will lift up your spirit. They will lift up your countenance where you are deflated, where you're hurting, where you're in pain, where you can't get any oxygen. Now all of a sudden, as you start to pray and start to cry out to God and start to give it to the Lord, it will lift you up out of that situation and you will no longer be overwhelmed. Look at verse 1 and 2 again. Look at what King David says. He says, hear my cry, O God. Attend to my prayer. From the end of the earth, I will cry to you. In other words, no matter how distant you feel like you are from God, one prayer will get you back in the presence of God. All you have to do is cry out to him, and he will be there running to your aid. I love how it says in the book of Daniel, from the moment you prayed, the answer was sent. Oh my goodness, I can just picture all of heaven waiting, paused, at attention, standing ready for the moment that a saint prays. And at that moment, God starts sending angels. God starts sending answers. God starts sending provisions. God starts sending the healing. God starts sending the power. God starts sending the direction. God starts sending the vision. God just starts sending the wisdom as we pray. The moment you pray, the moment you cry out, all of a sudden the answer is there. Look at what he says, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. See, oftentimes we don't know which way is up when we're overwhelmed. We don't have the right understanding that we need. And so we need God to lead us to the rock that is higher than I. In other words, if the waves have lifted up all around you, you're going to need some solid ground to stand on. And you don't know how to get there. You need God to lift you up out of that water. You need God to lift you up out of that circumstance. You need God to lift you up out of that situation and to set your feet upon the rock. See, you may fall to your knees overwhelmed, but you will rise an overcomer. You may fall to your knees overwhelmed, but you will rise an overcomer. See, no matter how high the problem may seem, our rock, his name is Jesus, is always higher. No matter how big the circumstance and the problem may feel, our God is always bigger. And so you need to release your prayers to a great, big God. Abraham Lincoln, everybody knows who he is, great president, but great trials that he went through. You can imagine the Civil War. You can imagine the polarization of our nation at that time. You can imagine the loss. You can imagine the tragedy. You can imagine all of the weights that were on him. And he said this. He said, I have been driven many times upon my knees by the overwhelming conviction that I had nowhere else to go. He went on to talk about, I had no wisdom. I had no understanding that could take care of what I needed. I had to go to the rock that is higher than I. He said, I had to go and I had to pray. James chapter 5, verse 13 in the New Testament. I love how simple God makes it. I love James. James is a fiery preacher. I would imagine if James came to the rock, he would fit right in. And James says this. It's so cool. James chapter 5, verse 13. He says, is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. That's it. Let him pray. He goes on to verse, anybody happy? Let him sing. Right? It's so simple, and yet sometimes it evades us. Wait, I'm overwhelmed. I need a 12-step. I need a 50-step. I need all kinds of things. I need all. No, if anybody's suffering, pray. That's it. Let them pray. When you feel overwhelmed, realize you have a problem, and then release the power of prayer. Start to pray. Start to cry out. Start to call on the Lord. That's why the Bible says, cast your cares upon him, because he cares for you. If you're suffering, start praying. If you're happy, start singing. Praise the Lord. We'll talk about that in a moment. Second thing is release your prayers. After that, what do you do? What do you do? Third thing is this, is remember his power. Psalm 61, verse number 3. King David, after he prays, after he cries out, after he calls to the Lord from the ends of the earth, he says, I'm overwhelmed, and yet I need you to lead me to the rock that is higher than I. And then look at verse number 3. He says, for you have been a shelter for me, a strong tower from the enemy. See, we need to remember God's power. We need to remember that God is greater than our circumstances. We need to remember that God has the power to carry us not only out of, but if he should so choose, through the circumstances. Sometimes circumstances won't change, but God will give you the power in order to walk through every trial and every circumstance. Sometimes the circumstance will change because God is greater than our circumstances, even though it seems like an insurmountable obstacle. Just like the children of Israel, like we sang tonight, as they faced the Red Sea, they were between a rock and a hard place. They had a swamp on one side. They had an army on the other side. They had a great lake on the other side. I mean, there was nowhere for them to go. And what does God do? He says, lift up your rod towards the sea, and I will start to part it so that you can walk through on dry land. Wow. See, God is greater than our circumstances. And where we see no way, there's no way out of it. This is just overwhelming. I don't understand how it's going to happen. I can't calculate it. I can't think about it. God says, you don't have to. Remember that I'm the one with the power. Remember that I'm the one who's mighty. Remember that I'm the one who's strong. Remember that I'm the one who can lift you up out of those waters and set your feet upon the rock. You've got to remember his power. Not only that, number four is this, recite his promises. Recite his promises. Psalm 61, verse number 4 through verse number 7, look at what it says. David continues on, and he says in verse 4, I will abide in your tabernacle forever. I will trust in the shelter of your wings. Selah, that means stop and think about this for a second. Take a moment, take a breath, right? Don't do anything. Allow the lifting power. You've prayed. You remember God is strong. Now start to recite the promises. He says, I will abide in your tabernacle forever. I will trust in the shelter of your wings. Verse 5, for you, O God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. You know, David knew the Bible that he had at that time. David understood the law of the Lord. David had read and had heard what God had spoken to him. And David had promises from God about his life. And therefore, David starts to declare and starts to rehearse and starts to not only remember, but starts to recite and starts to speak out the promises over his life. Verse 6, he says, "You will prolong the king's life, his years as many generations. He shall abide before God forever. Oh, prepare mercy and truth, which may preserve him." Now, I want you to notice something. He says there's a preserving power that God has. And this preserving power is mercy and truth. Now, mercy is when you were guilty and you were undeserving, and yet goodness was extended to you. God is a merciful God. In fact, the Bible says that mercy triumphs over judgment. That's pretty amazing when you think about it, because we all were deserving of judgment. We all were deserving of hell. We all were deserving not of rewards, but our actions were deserving of punishment. And yet, our sin was nailed to the cross with Jesus. And the punishment, the wrath of God, was poured out on Jesus on the cross on our behalf. And not only that, now God gives us his grace, he gives us his strength, his sovereign divine ability to get the job done on our behalf when we can't do it. That's where we remember his power. But as we start to rehearse covenant, we start to rehearse the promises of God that God said about our lives. Now all of a sudden, something comes in, mercy. Where we were undeserving, yeah, we're overwhelmed. Yes, life circumstances, and sometimes it's our own doing. Anybody can be honest in this place? Yes, right? We should have asked, we should have went, we should have done something, and yet we found ourselves in a circumstance. And you know, God is merciful. God's not saying, "Well, you made your bed, just lie in it." There are circumstances that we will have, you know, whatever you sow, you will reap. So we're going to have to go through some things. But God has not left us, and God has not forsaken us, and God is not mean-spirited. And the Bible says that if any lacks wisdom, he should ask of God, who gives liberally and without reproach. You know what that means? It means God's not laughing at you when you ask him for help. God doesn't say, "Oh, I was just waiting. It was about time you got over here, you stupid little thing." That's not God. God's saying, "Yes, thank you for asking." Remember, all of heaven is waiting for us to pray. All of heaven is waiting, poised, and just waiting to be activated on behalf of the saints. All of heaven, the angels are looking to God, waiting for just the little movement of his finger. Just go, just do it. Just move right now. Just bring it. And the angels are longing to look into the salvation of man. They're waiting. They are ministers sent on behalf of the saints, and they're ready. And we think, "Well, I am a worm, and you know, I'm not deserving. I'm not worthy." No, you're not. Get over it. God said ask. God said he's powerful. And God says that he has promises for your life that aren't because of your worth, but because of your new birth. Because you're a Christian. You're a part of the family of God. And it's not because of what we did. It's because of what he did. And therefore, in life, there are going to be times where you're overwhelmed. And God is saying, "Just bring it to me, child. Just come to me. Remember I'm strong." And start to rehearse the promises. Start to speak them. Start to recite them. Man, if you got to remind yourself 60 times a day, do what you got to do. Man, if you're overwhelmed by a health circumstance, start finding the healing scriptures in your Bible and start speaking them over your life. "By his stripes I was healed. By his stripes I was healed. By his stripes I was healed." You got to say that. You got to speak that. You got to get that rolling around in your spirit until you believe that. Because then when your faith is released, the power of God is released. You're looking for provision. Start to get a hold of the scriptures in your Bible. "Well, that's prosperity gospel." Yeah, that's a part of the gospel, guys. That's good news. It's good news that we can prosper. We don't have to be broke down, busted, and disgusted. No resource, no hope, no good in our lives. Bible says God gives us richly all things to enjoy. God doesn't want a bunch of sourpuss Christians that look like they've been sucking on lemons all their life. God wants us to be happy. He wants us to be prosperous. He wants us to be blessed. He wants us to be an example to everybody around us. You know, the Israelites in Goshen, they were blessed, and the Egyptians started going, "What's going on over there?" See, that's our lives. We have the blessing of God on our life so that people will say, "Wow, look at the Christians over there prospering. Look at how blessed they are." Man, look at their life. They have no need. Now, you may not be wealthy according to world standards, but you don't have any lack. You don't have any want of any good thing because the Lord will provide for you. But you got to get that in your spirit. You got to start reciting the promises. Children can be overwhelming. Parenting is hard. Oh my goodness. And as they get older, it doesn't get any easier. Can I get any teenage parent amens out there? All right. Thank God we have the youth over there tonight. They're like, amen. Get them over there. Get some Jesus in you, kid. But start to speak the promises. I'm raising them up in the way of the Lord that they shall not depart from them, even when they grow old. Though they may wander, they will return to their borders. My children are disciples, taught of the Lord, and great shall be their peace and their undisturbed composure. You got to get the promises being recited out of your mouth. Speak them out because there's power in your words. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. He who loves them shall live by them. I got to keep going. Not only realize the problem, release your prayers, remember his power, recite the promise. How about this one? Ring out in praise. Ring out in praise. Now, I like this one. Last verse, we're going to break it up in half, okay? Just look at the first part of the verse, verse number 8 in Psalm chapter 61. Look at what it says. So I will sing praise to your name forever. That's a long time, isn't it? But he says, I'm going to start now, and I'm going to go on into eternity singing your praise. See, when you're overwhelmed, and when you realize the problem, you start to pray. You fall to your knees. And you remember his power. God's strong. God's mighty. You know what? God's done something for me in the past. I know he'll do it again. Maybe God didn't do anything for you in the past except save you. That should be enough right there to get you going. But you know what? Maybe you say, well, maybe that's it. No, that's not it. But maybe God did something for someone else that you heard about. And you got all these examples in the Bible. God is powerful. God can do it. If he did it for them, he can do it for me. And then you start to recite the promise. Well, God, if you did it for Jeremiah, if you pulled him out of the pit, you'll pull me out of the pit. God, if you did it for Hezekiah, you gave him 10 more years of life. God, why wouldn't you do that for me? God, if you did it for David, who at the end of his life was full of years. God, why wouldn't you do that for me? Where he built the house of God and he left a legacy. And God, if you did it for David, who was a mess up, who was a screw up, won't you do it for me, God? But then what you got to do is you got to start to ring out in praise. So I will sing praise to your name forever. Well, you guys don't get it yet. You're saying, how can I praise, Pastor, when I'm overwhelmed? How can I start to sing out when I'm under waters? I don't have any air in my lungs. Because you remember his past faithfulness. Because you are reciting the promises over your future. See, being overwhelmed when you have God on your side may begin with tears, but it will end with praise. Sorrow may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And those who sow with tears shall come in reaping with sheaves, with joy, and with blessings. See, when God is on your side, you know God is up to something good. And even though you may not be able to see it right now, you can smile and you can praise. Why? Because God is moving on your behalf. God's going to do something in your life. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, you can just either turn there or I'll put it up on the overheads for you, but the man by the name of Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat was a great king. Jehoshaphat had a heart for the Lord. Jehoshaphat sent teachers out into Israel to teach them about the Bible that they had at their time. Teach them the will and the way of God. God blessed him abundantly. In fact, the Philistines, who were like a thorn in David's side and other kings, they started coming bringing him gifts. He was so blessed. This guy was prosperous in his life. And there came a time where not just one nation, not just two nations, but three nations decided they were going to come up against Jehoshaphat and the children of Israel. And so they came up against him. And these three kings got together, they got all their armies together, and they started camping out at En Gedi. And they were getting ready to go up and to fight with Jehoshaphat and the kingdom of Judah. And so here they are, and they're getting ready to come. And so Jehoshaphat, he's overwhelmed. You can imagine three kings and all their armies coming at you. That's an overwhelming thing, right? And so here he is, and he's going, what are we going to do? And so they start to pray, and they start to cry out before the Lord. And the Spirit of God comes on a guy, and he says, hey, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. God's going to do something. He starts to declare the will and the counsel of God. You can read about it in, like I said, 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And so Jehoshaphat, after he hears the word of the Lord, after he gets a hold of the promise of God, he does something unusual. Because God said he was going to do something. And so God said, I will take care of it. You don't have to worry about it. You're going to find them at this specific place. And I want you to go down there and I want you to see what I'm going to do there. So Jehoshaphat does something very unusual. If it was us, we would have said, okay, I'll go down there. I need everybody with a big spear in front. I need the guys with the shields right behind them. I need the archers ready to kill anybody who pops out behind them. And I need the swordsmen. I need the chariots. And me, I'm going to be in like the way back, right? So that no one can touch me. And we'll see what's going on. And we'll go very cautiously out there. But look at what Jehoshaphat does instead. He sets out the singers in front of his army. Now, if I was a singer, I'd be like, what is this, some kind of sick joke? What, you need the singers to go first? Is that what it is? We're going to die first? You just want to get us out? You didn't like our singing? Is that what it is? Sorry about the choir on Sunday, Pastor, right? In 2 Chronicles 20, 22, look at what it says. Now, when they began to sing and to praise. Everybody say to praise. Praise. See, there's something that happens when you start to ring out in praise. Look at what takes place. It says, when they began to sing in praise, the Lord set ambushes against the people of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir. That's the three nations that came against them, who had come against Judah. And look at this. And they were defeated. See, there may be circumstances coming at you from several directions. Devil might be attacking on one side, your flesh might be attacking on the other side, and your family might be on the other side. Come on, somebody. Can we talk? And yet, when you start to praise God, when you start to ring out a praise to the Lord, God will deliver you. God will take care of you. And all of those circumstances have to bow to the name of Jesus. And they have to lay down in front of his praise. That doesn't mean go tell your wife, go lay down, honey. That, you just don't do that, all right? Acts chapter 16, turn there with me. That was a joke, by the way. Thank you for those two courtesy laughs. Acts chapter 16, the Apostle Paul, his ministry partner Silas, they're doing great things for God, and they end up making people mad, as oftentimes the gospel does. And so they end up in prison. Now I want you to see the situation they were in. Acts chapter 16, verse number 24 starts out and says this. Acts chapter 16, verse 24 says, having received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. So Paul and Silas are charged, and having received such a charge, the jailer puts them into the, not just the prison, the inner prison. See, there were levels that they had, and as you went deeper, it got danker. Come on. It got worse. It was bad. And there was no restroom facilities. There was no three square meals a day. They were in the inner prison. So any, you know, human waste, it was right there on the floor. Feet are in the stocks. That's a bad day. Can you say, yeah, I hear that, right? That could be overwhelming to any one of us. Verse 25, but at midnight, notice darkness has covered them. They are overwhelmed with the situation. And it's the middle of the night where they have no power, they have no light, they don't got anything, they don't even got sleep at this point. At midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. I can just imagine what the prison sounded like. You know, here it is, you hear the cricket off in the distance, you hear maybe a chain as somebody rolls over, and then all of a sudden you hear off in the distance two Jews start singing praises. All of a sudden, here, a voice sings out, amazing grace, how sweet the sound. And they start singing. It's the middle of the night. Prisoners are waking up. What's going on? What's happening? Now, look at what takes place. It says, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Notice everybody in the prison started listening. They started hearing the sound of praise. It started to fill up the prison that they were in. And it goes on and it says this, the next verse, it says, suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were loosed. See, sometimes when you get in the middle of a circumstance and you feel like you're bound up and you're overwhelmed, and you are praying to God, it's time to go from prayer to praise. It's time to cross over from praying to God to praising God, to start lifting up the name of Jesus, to start exalting God, to magnify Him over your situation, and to let everybody around you know, my God is good, my God is great, my God's going to take care of me, my God is faithful, my God is true, my God is powerful. And as you do, you don't know if not only your chains and your prison doors will be open, but everybody around you, their chains and their prison doors will be open, because God will bless you so much that it will overflow into the people around you. Wow. See, when your cup runneth over, the table gets blessed. God doesn't want you just storing up everything for yourself. God wants you to be a blessing. Ring out and praise. And the last one is this, readily perform. Psalm 61, verse 8, the last part of the verse says this, that I may daily perform my vows. That I may daily perform my vows. Every day, it's a partnership. Every day, you have a part to play. S.D. Gordon said this. He said, prayer is striking the winning blow. Service is gathering the results. When you're overwhelmed and you realize the problem, and you start to pray, you start to lift up your voice in praise, remembering the power of God, you ring out that praise before the Lord. Now there's a part that you have to play. You have to readily perform what God is asking you to do. To everything in our lives, there is a God part and there is a man part. God does not want to do anything in our lives without a partnership. And that's the super and the natural. There's a part that God does, and it's always the weightier part. It's always the greater part. It's always the harder part. Why? Because God is able. And because God gets glory for that. But even in the commandment, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, when the children of Israel were overwhelmed with the army that was coming behind them, they still had a part to play, and that's stand still. It takes a willful inactivity at that moment to stand still, because we want to go out and we want to do everything, don't we? But whatever God has called you to do and whatever you told God you were going to do, that's why he said, I will daily perform my vows. These are the things that he promised God he was going to do. You have a part to play. If you're overwhelmed by a circumstance that you're in because you're in it and you said, God, I'll stop. God, I'm done. God, I'll take care of it. God, I'll break it off. God, whatever you told God, you need to do it. Oh, but it's going to hurt if I do it. Yeah, but you need to do it. Oh, but I don't know if I can make it if I do it. You need to do it. God is saying something to you. He's saying, look at King David. Look at the life. Here was a man who was overwhelmed. And yet, I led him to the rock that was higher than he was. And I took care of him all throughout his days. You know, David's story, as you read about it, man, that guy left the kingdom several times. That guy was wronged several times. The guy had things, people turned their back on him. His closest associates, in fact, as you read through the Psalms, you'll find out, he said, we went to the house of God together. Man, we were in church together. And yet you still backstabbed me. And yet, after all that, he doesn't blame God. He says, God, I will daily perform my vows. God, I'm going to do what you've called me to do, but God, I'm also going to do what I said I would do. And he took it, and he went with it, and he ran with it. It was a partnership. God is always the greater partner. God will do what he said he would do. We do our part. God does his part. We put in our natural. God puts in his super. And now all of a sudden, it becomes a supernatural experience with God. And you will no longer be overwhelmed. What did we learn tonight? When you shout, help, I'm overwhelmed, we got to realize the problem. You may not know which way is up. Just hang for a minute. Release your prayers. Start to cry out to the Lord. Let that lift you. Remember his power. Remember what God has done. Remember his faithfulness. Recite his promises. Start to speak out the word of God out loud, out of your mouth. Even if you feel like a crazy person doing it, it's okay. Feel like a crazy person and doing it, because it's better than being overwhelmed. Start to recite his promises. Ring out in praise. Lift up a cry and a shout to God, and watch the shackles fall off of you and the people around you. And finally, readily perform. Whatever you got to do, do it. Come on, if you got something from the word of the Lord tonight, give God a praise. Hallelujah. God is so good. It's just practical help from the Word of God. Yes, it's spiritual in prayer. Yes, it's spiritual in praise, but it's also practical in how to handle when you're overwhelmed. I want to take a couple moments of your time tonight before we leave this place. Church is not done yet. I got one more thing I want to do. And for many of you in this place tonight, this is the most important part of the church service. So I'm going to ask nobody distract anybody else around you. Nobody get up. No one leave during this time. If you got your phone or electronic device out or on, I'd ask you to turn it off, mute it. Let's cut out distractions because I want to speak to people tonight about their eternity. I want to make sure before you leave this place that your heart is right with God and that if you died, that you'd go to heaven and that you wouldn't go to hell. I know we told a joke about heaven tonight, but heaven is not a joke. It's a very real place. And there are real rewards awaiting us in eternity. But guess what? Hell is also not a joke. It's a very real place. It's not an imaginative place that's been made up. And I want to make sure that you don't end up there. Sometimes people say, well, I don't believe in hell. Well, listen, if you don't believe in it, it doesn't make it go away. It's real. You're going to have to face the reality of it. And just by denying its existence doesn't make it go away. We're not promised tomorrow. We're all one incident, one virus, one breath away from eternity. We see that each and every day of our lives. And I want to make sure that today, if it was your last day on the earth and you died, that you would go to heaven and that you wouldn't go to hell. Sometimes people get messed up on how to get to heaven. They say, well, all roads lead to heaven, right? God is good. And I don't believe God would send people to hell. And therefore, everybody's going to heaven. You do your thing, I'll do my thing. The church is out there, whatever they believe, they can do that. As long as we stay true to ourselves, God sees that. And he'll let us into heaven because all roads lead to heaven. But what if we applied that logic to the earth? Let's do that for a moment, shall we? All roads lead to the moon on the earth. We'd say, no way, you're crazy. You can drive around the earth as long as you want and you'll never make it. Well, in the same way, what makes us think that that applies to heaven, that all roads lead to heaven? There's only one way you're going to make it to heaven. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man goes to the Father except by me. That means it's God's heaven and we got to get there God's way. And the way to heaven is not open and expansive. It's not all roads. In fact, the Bible says it's a narrow road, difficult to find, and there's few who find it. Tonight, I want to shine some light on the path for you. Make sure that you make it. Sometimes people think that good works are the way to heaven. Well, if you do enough good, that God is like some jolly old Saint Nick in the heavenlies, making a list and checking it twice of who's been naughty and who's been nice. Listen, it's not like that. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can be good enough with your good works, your good deeds, your charitable donations, getting involved in social justice or anything like that. That's not going to make it to heaven. You can't get to heaven based on your goodness. How do I know that? Because the Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And you're not going to make it to heaven based on your own goodness. You're going to have to get there God's way. And our goodness compared to God's goodness in the Bible is compared to filthy rags. Listen, filthy rags are going to get thrown out. They're not going to get to stay. Can't make it to heaven just by being good. Sometimes people think, well, Pastor, hold on a second, because I was raised in church. I believe I'm going to go to heaven because I was born in a Christian home, born in a Christian nation. This is America. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any of the religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. We're Christians. When I was raised in church, they had me baptized or christened as a child. Maybe they hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, took you to religious classes like Sunday school, Sabbath school, catechism class. And yet, did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you are born into a Christian home, quote unquote, born into a Christian nation, quote unquote, that you get to go to heaven? There is no Christian nation. Do you know that? Nowhere in the Bible say be born in America or any other nation that calls themselves Christians and that gets you to heaven. No, in the Bible say that you're raised in church, parents tell you Christians, take you to religious classes, wear religious jewelry, or that you're baptized or christened as a child, you get to go to heaven. And nowhere, check it out, nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're not some other religion that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Listen, tonight, I love you enough to tell you the truth and not play games. You're not going to make it. Some of these places said, well, not only when I was a child did I go to church, here I am sitting in church right now. And doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? I consider myself to be a Christian. I'm sitting in church. I wouldn't be here if I didn't think that. Well, I'm glad you're here tonight. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible say because you sit in church service, call yourself Christian, that makes you Christian? It's like me saying, I really want to be one of the Angels baseball players. And so I go down to Anaheim. I bring an Angels uniform, put it on, wear it, bring my bat and my ball, my glove, sit in the dugout, say, I'm an Angel, I'm an Angel, I'm an Angel. I'm going to get to play baseball in the game. You know what's going to happen? They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out, and lock me up. You know why? Because I am not a member of the Angels baseball organization. In the same way, you can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, and that makes you a Christian. Sometimes people say, but hold on a second, Pastor. My last church I got involved in, I helped out, sang in the choir, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I got a membership card to that church, even taught the Bible classes. That's great. I'm glad you did those things. Just show that to me in the Bible, could you, where your church involvement gets into heaven? Nowhere in the Bible say, help out, sing in the choir, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions. People think of you as a leader. You get to go to heaven. It doesn't work like that. Nowhere, check it out, nowhere in the Bible say God is waiting at the gates of heaven looking for your membership card to a church or to see if you taught in a class before you can enter. You're not going to make it based on your church involvement. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I get all that, but you don't understand. I know who God is. I know about Jesus and the resurrection at Easter. Celebrate Christmas and sing the songs every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you from the Old and the New Testament. Doesn't that mean something? Well, yeah, it means that you know who God is up here in your head. But did you know that demons know who Jesus is? They know who he is. They cry out, you're the Son of God, when they see him. And the devil himself, you can find it in your Bible, can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about you having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. But rather, this is about your heart. Jesus said it like this. He said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. It's just that simple. That is the way that God has outlined in his word for us to get to heaven. You must be born again. Not it's a way, not it's a good thing if you did it. Hopefully you do. No, you must be born again. Now, I know. When we say born again, everybody turns off. They say, ugh, I saw that in a movie, read about that on the internet. That's just a weirdo thing. I want to have any part of that. Well, listen, if you don't have any part of that, you don't have any part of the kingdom of heaven, and you're not going to make it. Because Jesus said you must be born again to enter. No other option. You must be born again. Now, let's not let Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet define for us what being born again is. Let's let the Bible do that for us, shall we? What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it means the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, that's pretty gross, right? Pretty graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what is he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus Christ, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So tonight, I'm going to give you an opportunity. I'm going to tell you exactly what we're going to do in a moment. In a moment, I'm going to ask everybody in this place to just bow your heads and close your eyes. I'm going to ask you the question that we started with. What if today was your last day on the earth? Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? I want you to answer that question in your heart. No one will know the answer but you and God. And if you answered that question, I think I'd go, maybe I'd go, I really don't know. Any other answer than I know that I know that I know that I know, then tonight you need to give your heart and life to Jesus. As I ask that question, give you a moment to answer it right afterwards, then I'm going to count to three. One, two, three, and I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand if you want to give your heart and life to Jesus. Be born again, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. You can look up and connect with me. I'll see your hand, and I'll see you look up at me, and then I'll acknowledge you, and you can put your hand right back down. No one's going to be looking around. No one's judging, criticizing, condemning. We all love you and we're all excited for you. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. I'm a man, I'll see it go up. I'll count it, you can put it right back down. But he also said this. He said, if you deny me, I will deny you. What does that mean? That means if tonight you know you need to get right with God, you know you wouldn't make it, and you sit there and do nothing, that you've made a choice. And so tonight, your call, your choice. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Tonight is your night. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before? Giving them all of your heart and all of your life. I'm speaking to you. Finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. And then right after I count, the hands that go up, then I'm going to lead you in a prayer. We'll invite you down to the front. We'll all pray together. The whole church will join in with you to encourage you. Man, it's going to be great. And if you want to be included in that prayer, get ready to get your hands up. So let's all bow our heads. Let's all close our eyes. Come on. Everybody do this right now. Just bow your heads, close your eyes. And I want to ask you that question once again. What if today was your last day on the earth? Would you make it to heaven or would you go to hell? Just answer that question in your heart. No one knows the answer but you and God. Remember, if you didn't say, I know that I know that I know that I know, then you need to get ready to get your hand up. I'm going to count to three. And if you want to be included in that prayer, get ready to get your hands up. Here we go. Been running from God instead of to God. I'm speaking to you. One, not sure about your salvation. Tonight is your night. Two, come on, lukewarm in this place. Get ready to get your hand up. Here we go. Three, let me see your hands. Just raise them up high if that's you. Thank you. There's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Got you over there. Who else tonight? Eight, nine over there. I got you guys. Got you guys. There's nine wise people already. 10 over there. Got you. Thank you. 10 wise people already. Who else tonight? Who else tonight? If I didn't already see you, but you got your hand up and you don't think I've connected with you, just give me a little wave if that's you. Anybody else? Thank you. Got you over there, number 11. God bless you. Who else? Thanks for the wave. Thank you in the family room. Got you over there, 12. Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else that I did not already see? If you're saying, yeah, I want to be, there you are, number 13. God bless you. Who else tonight? Who else tonight? Need to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Want to be included in that prayer at a moment. Anybody else? Yes, got you right here. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you, number 14. Who else tonight? Anybody else real quick? Number 15, if you're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, you should. Let's go. Let's go tonight. Just get your hand up. I didn't embarrass anybody in this place. I won't embarrass you. Anybody else? Come on, number 15. If that's you, just raise it up. Connect me with me right now. Just look up and raise your hand. If that's you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Is that a hand right there? Okay, number 15, gotcha. God bless you. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 15 wise people. Okay, we're going to pray. We're going to pray. I want you, if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, get a hold of your cold purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Why don't you get in the aisle and meet me up front. If your children raise their hand, ask them right now because your eyes may have been closed. Hey, did you raise your hand? And if they say yes, bring them up here tonight because we're going to pray together, okay? So even if you're in the family rooms, hey, your children are welcome at this time. You can come right now. If you're in the foyer, come on back in to the church service or tell an usher right afterwards. Let's all stand. And if you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, come on, let's pray together right now. Come on down. Let's welcome them as they come. Come on, they're coming. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. Come on, anybody else, if you raise your hand, you should raise your hand. Come on down right now. Come on down right now. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too. Love to shake your hand, man. God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Come on down. Man, good job. Good job. Anybody else? Come on down. This is your time. This is your moment. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Come on, let's keep it going for them. If you're needing to come, you come right now. All right. Hey, so glad you all came tonight. We're going to pray together just like I said, all right? This is the moment where you're going to be born again. God's going to come into your heart and life and just recreate you, make you brand new. This is the best decision of your entire life. Okay, we're going to pray a prayer. I'm going to lead you with simple phrases. I want you to repeat them out loud if you have the ability, okay? Just short phrases. And listen, if you mess up on a word or two, it's okay, all right? It's not about the words of your mouth. It's about the prayer of your heart going before the Lord tonight, okay? So let's all bow our heads. Once again, let's close our eyes, and I want you to say these words. Everybody's going to join in. Say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. I give you all my heart and all my life. Come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior. Wash me with your blood. Cleanse me of my past. And give me a brand new start with a brand new heart. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That He came, that He died, and He was raised again to life just for me. Thank you, Jesus. Fill me now with Your Holy Spirit. And let it be known that from this day on, I am a Christian. I'm headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight. God is good. Wow, more showed up. Glad you guys came. Hey, we want to give some free information, some free literature, help you to find out what to do next in your walk with God, and connect you with someone here in the church who just wants to invest some time in you. It's easy. It's free. We want to take a couple minutes of your time, then we'll let you come right back out in church service, okay? Your friends and family will wait for you. This is Reverend Antonio, all right? You can call him Tony. He's a really good guy. So if you guys will just make a left turn, follow Tony right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Love you, Rev. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight.